Hi, I'm Christopher Ho, a second-year general surgery resident at SingHealth, and I'll be speaking to you today on the diagnosis of breast cancer. I will start by introducing the breast as an organ, give a brief epidemiological background to breast cancer, describe breast cancer screening, introduce some important imaging and pathological tools clinicians utilize to aid the diagnosis of breast cancer. Hopefully, by the end of my talk, you will be familiar with the structure of the breast, become aware of the global burden of breast cancer, and understand the importance of triple assessment in breast cancer screening. You should also come away with the theoretical knowledge of how to examine the breast, but I must add that there is no substitute for continuous practice on patients and critique by those more experienced than you are. You should also have a basic grasp of the commonly used radiological adjuncts, namely breast ultrasound and mammography, and the histological and cytological tools used in breast cancer screening. Right, let's get stuck in. The breast is essentially a modified sweat gland derived from the ectoderm. It is cushioned in fat and lies between the superficial and deep fascial layers of the anterior chest wall. Each breast comprises 15 to 20 milk-producing lobules that flow into ducts which may coalesce at the nipple. Each nipple may have 15 to 20 such orifices. Fibrous septa, or Cooper's ligaments, interdigitate the mammary parenchyma extending from the deep pectoral fascia to the superficial pectoral fascia within the dermis and provide structural support to the breast. Now, a commonly asked question in theatre is, describe the margins of the breast. At this point, you should politely clear your throat and calmly reply, base of the breast extends from the second to sixth ribs and is bound medially by the lateral margin of the sternum and laterally by the mid-axillary line. The arterial supply of the breast is mainly from the internal mammary artery, which also goes by the name internal thoracic artery. Other arteries supplying the breast include the intercostal, thoracoacromial, and lateral thoracic arteries. It is drained by Batson's plexus, a valveless network of veins that connect the thoracic and pelvic veins to the internal vertebral venous plexus. And it is thought that Batson's plexus allows hematogenous spread of cancer cells to the spine. Axillary lymph nodes provide approximately 97% of lymphatic drainage, with the remaining going to the internal mammary nodes. Hormones play a large role in the development and cyclical changes of the breast. Estrogen promotes the development of ducts, which are a double layer of columnar cells. It also causes swelling of the breast and growth of glandular tissue. Progesterone promotes lobular development and increases the maturation of glandular tissue. Prolactin is synergistic with the actions of both estrogen and progesterone. After menopause, it is the lack of estrogen and progesterone that results in the atrophy of breast tissue. Breast cancer is primarily a disease of developed nations. Its incidence increases with progressive affluence. It affects approximately 1 in 8 American women, 1 in 11 British women, and 1 in 18 Singaporean women. It is by far the most common female non-skin cancer and accounts for approximately 30% of female cancers in both Singapore and the US. Locally, it accounts for 15% of all female cancer deaths. Next, we have a rather busy slide showing numerous risk factors for breast cancer and their relative risks. Far too many to go through in detail, but you should remember a few important ones. Female sex, age, lifetime estrogen exposure, personal and family history, and inherited genetic mutations. Now, breast cancer screening, which is the detection of breast cancer in asymptomatic, apparently healthy women without signs or symptoms of the disease. It first started in 1988 in the United Kingdom and has been replicated in varying shapes and sizes in many other countries. Each nation formulates its guidelines based on local population data, age-specific incidence and costs, and each program should ideally be audited regularly to ensure its effectiveness in decreasing mortality from breast cancer. In the Singaporean context, screening for breast cancer starts in females from the age of 40 till the age of 70. All women between those ages should have a physical examination annually, in addition to monthly self-examination. From the age of 40 to 49, women should have a yearly mammogram, which then becomes 2 yearly upon reaching the age of 50. The triple assessment is a very important concept to grasp. All patients, when coming to the breast clinic, should have their breasts examined. If examination reveals something suspicious, or if they fall within the age guidelines for screening but have not had any imaging before, women should have either a mammogram, an ultrasound, or both, as appropriate. If they have had recent imaging within the recommended time frame but now present with a new complaint, then repeat imaging should also be sought. Finally, if mammogram or ultrasound reveals something suspicious, then histological or cytological sampling is required. If the results of imaging are inconsistent with your physical findings, then either repeat imaging, imaging with a different modality, or pathological assessment is usually required. If you understand this logic and adhere fastidiously to these steps, an accurate diagnosis can be achieved in 99% of all patients. Although it doesn't strictly form part of the triple assessment criteria, history taking is nonetheless important when assessing a patient. Don't forget to inquire about the risk factors mentioned previously. They will guide your subsequent management. The most common complaint in women with breast cancer is that of a firm, non-tender, poorly circumscribed breast lump. Dimpling of the skin and nipple inversion occurs when Cooper's ligaments that hold up the breast become involved, resulting in architectural distortion and asymmetry compared with the contralateral breast. Peau de orange occurs when cancer cells invade the dermal lymphatics, resulting in the characteristic edema and erythema. Paget's disease of the nipple has the outward appearance of eczema, however the cells are malignant. In addition, usually also indicates another underlying breast cancer. Breast cancer may also present with bloody nipple discharge. Systemic features are an ominous sign that may indicate metastases. For example, thoracic spine pain may indicate spread to the vertebrae. Jaundice and hepatomegaly may indicate liver metastases. And shortness of breath may be the result of a malignant pleural effusion or nodule. Finally, patients may also show you a set of what they have been told is abnormal radiological results. Based on your clinical assessment and the patient's images, you will have to decide on the next course of action. Now, this is only meant to be a brief guide to examining the breast. You should supplement whatever I say with the book on clinical examination. Start by introducing yourself and explain what you are about to do. Allow the patient to undress behind curtains. With the chaperone present at all times, seat the patient upright with both her hands on her hips. Inspect for any skin or nipple changes, discharge, and asymmetry. Ask the patient to push her hands into her hips. This may allow deeper masses attached to the underlying pectoralis muscle to become more prominent. Ask the patient to raise her hands above her head. This will accentuate any skin changes. Next, inform the patient to lie down on the couch and in a clockwise manner, palpate her breast. You may choose to perform this with either one hand or both hands. Always palpate the normal breast first. It is important to palpate the upper outer quadrant and the axillary tail. As you can see on the cartoon, 50% of breast cancers occur in that region. Do not forget to palpate the nipple and retroareola region either. They are also a common site for breast cancer. Press on the areola to elicit discharge, but please inform the patient of what you are about to do first. To identify lymphadenopathy, hold the patient's arm with one arm and gently palpate her axilla with your free hand. Do this for both sides. Next, proceed to palpate her supraclavicular and cervical regions. Then proceed to palpate the patient's thoracic spine, feel for an enlarged liver, and auscultate the patient's lungs. Finally, thank the patient and allow her to get dressed. We will now move on to imaging. Mammography is the process of using low-energy X-rays to image the breast. It has 90% sensitivity 90% specificity. Sensitivity increases with age as dense parenchymal tissue is replaced with fat. Two views of the breast are obtained, cranial caudal and medial lateral oblique. In the former, the breast is compressed and an X-ray taken in the superior inferior plane. In the latter, the breast is compressed and an X-ray taken in an angled medial to lateral plane. Masses need to be 5 mm or larger in size in order for it to be detected on mammogram. Mammographic features of breast cancer include a mass with irregular borders, spiculation, distortion of surrounding architecture, ductal asymmetry, asymmetric density, or multiple clustered, small, thin, linear or branching calcifications. Suspicious mammographic lesions may require pathological assessment. Ultrasound is another commonly used imaging modality. It is very helpful in patients under the age of 40 whose dense breast parenchyma impedes the penetration of X-rays. It is particularly useful in the evaluation of masses, where it can distinguish between cystic or solid lesions. Like mammograms, they are useful in lesions 5 mm or more in size. Suspicious sonographic features include spiculated contours, taller than wide orientation, angular margins, hypoechogenicity, microlobulations, and punctate calcifications. Presence of such lesions may require cytological or histological evaluation. It is very common for abnormalities to be found on imaging. Most findings are usually benign, however, suspicious features may occasionally be present. In order to standardize mammogram reporting and to compare mammograms, as well as to help clinicians determine whether or not further investigation is necessary, the American College of Radiologists came up with the Breast Imaging Reporting and Data System, or BIRADS. This is essentially the radiologist's opinion of the absence or presence of breast cancer. As seen on the slide, there are 7 categories of reporting, from 0 to 6, and each category has its corresponding recommendation. The BIRADS system, although initially developed for mammography, has now also been adapted and validated for breast ultrasound and MRI. For the last part of my talk, I shall briefly mention some common pathological tools to help ascertain the diagnosis of malignancy. Fine needle aspiration cytology, or FNAC, is a safe and simple procedure using a fine gauge needle to obtain cells, not tissue. This is commonly done for palpable breast lumps. Although operator dependent, FNAC has a diagnostic accuracy rate of between 90 to 94%. Essentially, a 21 or 23 gauge needle is passed several times into the breast lump in question to obtain cells. These cells are then flushed using a syringe attached to the needle onto a glass slide, which is then fixed and stained. In the event that no epithelial cells are obtained, i.e. a non-diagnostic sample, FNAC should be repeated or a biopsy should be considered. If non-bloody fluid is aspirated and the mass disappears, no further workup is required. If bloody fluid is aspirated, the mass remains after aspiration, or the cyst recurs more than twice, excisional biopsy is recommended. A simple cyst on ultrasound does not require further workup. If cytological findings are discordant with imaging, excision biopsy is also recommended. Remember, FNAC cannot help to distinguish in situ disease from invasive disease, as only cells are obtained, so only cytological examination is possible. This will confirm if malignant cells are present, but will not tell you if the cancer has invaded. To do so, histological evaluation is required to obtain tissue architecture. Which brings us to the next slide. Core biopsy is a form of histological assessment that utilizes a large caliber needle that is percutaneously inserted into the lesion in question to obtain a tissue core. Many modern core biopsy needles, such as the TrueCut needle, are now incorporated into devices that combine incision and cutting functions. Core biopsy may be used on its own for palpable masses, or in conjunction with image guidance such as ultrasound or mammography for non-palpable lesions. Several specimens should be collected. Excisional biopsy, or surgical biopsy, is the gold standard method for tissue diagnosis. The entire mass should be excised with a 1 cm margin of normal tissue. Non-palpable lesions may be localized with a wire inserted into the center of the lesion under mammographic or sonographic guidance. Post biopsy, an X-ray of the lesion with the wire still in situ should be taken. Ideally, the incision should be made such that a future mastectomy can incorporate the biopsy site. And that brings us to the end of the talk. I hope that I've impressed upon you that breast cancer is very common, and it should always be at the back of your mind when a woman presents to you with breast-related complaints, regardless of age or symptom. Early detection has been shown to decrease mortality, so remember the local breast cancer screening guidelines and encourage all female patients of suitable age to attend. When assessing any lesion, adhere to the triple assessment strategy: serial examination, mammogram, and pathology. If all three modalities indicate a benign lesion, then you can be 99% confident that the lesion is indeed benign. For those of you interested or want to know more about this topic, I recommend reading the following materials. Otherwise, please feel free to email me at the address on the first slide. I would like to thank Dr. Preeta Matkuma for her invitation to give this lecture and her guidance in preparing these slides. I would also like to thank the team at Duke NUS for their patience and assistance in making this voice-annotated presentation possible. Thank you for listening.